which was home to 8 teams at the start of the week here at the Women's College World Series. Only 5 remain. Only 4 will remain after tonight's elimination game between 4th-seeded Tennessee and 6th-seeded Oklahoma State.
Fear is real. It lurks. It sneaks up. It attacks. Today is no different.
Been a long night, but I'm still fighting.
It is win or go home.
Here's the secret that fighters know. Fear is not your enemy. Fear is the shadow of that great life. Fear allows you to know the truth about who you are.
There is no stopping this Oklahoma State train.
Someone's going to lose, but recognize what's real.
Riley West has broken this game open.
Only you can decide to make it your best day.
It's a good day coming. It's a good day coming.
You're watching the NCAA Women's College World Series presented by Capital One. Elimination Sunday, one spot in the semifinals up for grabs between OSU and Tennessee. The third semifinal spot today was snatched by Stanford. A star in the making in the circle, Nijeri Kennedy, twirling the Cardinals' second consecutive one-hit shutout as they knocked out Washington in an all Pac-12 matchup. That sets up Stanford and Oklahoma tomorrow at noon Eastern, 11 local. Florida State awaiting the winner of this game between the 4 and the 6 seeds. And we are thrilled to be here for what should be an epic evening of softball. Kevin Brown, 2-time All-American, Amanda Scarborough. We have seen these teams at their worst and at their best in these World Series. Both run ruled in one game, both breaking individual program records for runs in a World Series game and the other. And Tennessee got 10 in the opener against Alabama. They are one of the highest scoring teams in the country.
Yeah, they are, and their offense was what started to click later on as the year has gone on. It's becoming more complete offense. From the beginning of the year, this is a team really centered around a pitching staff, a deep pitching staff with their ace, Ashley Rogers, a transfer in Peyton Gottschall, and a freshman in Carlin Pickens to have one of the best ERAs in the country all year long. That complete offense is led by Kiki Malloy and Zeta Puni at the top. They're hitting a combined 400 batting average and tons of home run and power. They hit 1 and 2. They are so tough at the top of the order, create a lot of runs for this offense.
They do basically everything well, the Lady Vols. Top 3 in the nation in runs per game, on base percentage, shutouts, and opposing batting average. And they will send Ashley Rogers, the 5th-year senior, to the circle tonight. Oklahoma State, meanwhile, an 8-0 loss to Florida State, followed by an 8-0 win over Utah. Not a big home run hitting team, but the Cowboys, when they get going, they are hard to stop.
Yeah, they just find ways to score runs in different ways, not necessarily with the long ball and a ton of power, but when this team starts to execute, they can put runs on the board quickly. They did get shut out, but then in an elimination game, their bats came alive. They wasted no time, scoring 2 runs in the first, 6 runs in the second with that run rule win, and that is an offense they're going to need to bring tonight. When they are confident in executing, this offense can score a lot of runs as well.
These Cowgirls have made 4 consecutive trips to the World Series. They are about as experienced as anyone here. A whole bunch of players not wanting to end their careers here. Rachel Becker, the transfer from Purdue, Kylie Naomi, and Cheyenne Factor. More than 750 games played combined in their extraordinary careers. 2 of the most decorated programs in college softball without a World Series championship. Nobody's been here more without a title than Oklahoma State. Tennessee right behind. 1 will be going home. 1 will be going to the semifinals. Beautiful night, beautiful crowd here at Hall of Fame Stadium. Time for tonight's starting lineups presented by Capital One. For Oklahoma State, led by Kylie Naomi, so many wonderful postseason moments in her career, the most runs scored in Oklahoma State history, the most games played of any active player at an All-American this season, one of two All-Americans in the lineup. To oppose an All-American herself, a first-team pick, Ashley Rogers, among the nation's best, the only scholarship player who will run out of eligibility after this World Series for Tennessee. Rogers to Rachel Becker, and we begin with a first pitch strike. 6:06 local on this Sunday night, June the 4th, here in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, 79 degrees at game time. Another lovely night for softball here at the World Series.
Ball
and a strike for Becker, the Purdue transfer. Her first and only Oklahoma State year has been an extraordinarily impactful one. In the top 10 of the nation in doubles, hits, and on-base percentage. We wondered if it would be Peyton Gottschall, who pitched well down the stretch, or Ashley Rogers, who has been a little banged up, and it is Rogers in the circle for Tennessee.
Looked like actually two. I believe the third base umpire may have just called an illegal pitch on Ashley Rogers, so that was a foul ball, and that will go down as a ball instead.
So 2-1 count instead. That means that strike does not end the at-bat. It makes it 2-2. Was Dustin Douglas, the umpire from third, who had the illegal pitch. So two balls, two strikes on Becker.
Always a tough out at the top. It seems to be her first at bat. Her leadoff at bat is always her best at bat, where she sees the most pitches, fouls off a lot of pitches, and you mentioned that she's a transfer, and the first game of the year had a 9 or 10 pitch at bat and hasn't looked back.
On base percentage of 561, and Becker will run the count full against Rogers. This is an Oklahoma State team that has broken the school record for total runs, third in school history in runs per game at 6.1. Year 8 for Kenny Gajewski and his fourth straight trip to the World Series. Good. And Rachel Becker's doing exactly what she does almost every night to start the game.
Has seen more pitches on her first plate appearance of the game. She ups it by, if I do a little quick math, 25%. Crazy numbers. It always feels like she has long at bats, and the numbers back it up.
And a pitch one here. She takes one a little bit tight. Tom Meyer has it low. Becker has the leadoff walk against Rogers.
And Ashley Rogers will move the ball around, and she has very good spin and movement. It's what keeps hitters guessing. She'll go down the zone with the drop ball, but mostly be up in the zone with the rise ball, a curve ball, including it throwing it backdoor and a changeup. When you look at her heat map where she gets her most swings and misses, it's going to be more up in the zone with her rise ball. So that red area is inside, up and in to right-handed hitters and outside to lefties.
Here's a bunt from Cheyenne Factor. This is an Oklahoma State staple. Get Becker on via a walk or a single. Let Factor bunt her over. Cheyenne Factor with her 14th sacrifice bunt of the season. She's one home run away from the career 30-30 club, Factor. She has 35, now 36 sack bunts and 29 home runs. So an 8-pitch walk followed by a 1-pitch sacrifice. And Kylie Naomi will swing it
ball
and take ball one. No active player has appeared in more Division I games than Kylie Naomi, her 267th today, an extraordinary year at the plate. Terrific in the field for her entire career. And they love pushing Becker to second. They love sacrificing her, even though it means giving up an out, because Naomi leads the Big 12 in RBIs. 65 runs batted in 62 games for Kylie Naomi. And she chases one here.
that nasty rise ball. And when Ashley Rogers is getting swings and misses like that with her rise ball, that is a good sign. Makes it even tougher for opponents to see the pitch out of her hand with that sharp movement that she has. Not an overpowering pitcher with speed, but deceptive movement.
Runners in scoring position this season, outrageous numbers for Naomi. Rogers 1-2.
Ball.
Only Zeta Pooney, who stares down at Kylie Naomi from third, has more RBIs in this NCAA tournament. Pooney with a baker's dozen. One ahead of Naomi. Will hit a little dribbler. Back to Rogers out of the circle. She floats it in time. Gets the second out with Becker moving up a base.
Now batting for the count drills, number 26, Morgan Wynn.
So Morgan Wynn will step in with two down. Whole lot of space in the middle of the field for Wynn, who has hit some absolute rockets to the pole side this postseason.
And you can tell how far back that the left fielder Riley West is playing for Tennessee, too, respecting that pole side power for her.
Wynn into shallow center. Malloy coming in late. She is there to make the play, and Becker is stranded at third. Malloy with a catch. Malloy will lead off the home first coming up. Tennessee Lady Vols at 50-9 will bat in their third game of this Women's College World Series. Starting lineups presented by Capital One. The nation's second highest scoring team, led by Kiki Malloy, leads the nation in home runs total with 25, leads the nation in leadoff home runs with 7. Zeta Pooney, the most RBIs in the tournament, in back of her, and the Lady Vols will send 8 right-handed batters to the plate, led off by the All-American Malloy. And they will face a left-hander, Oklahoma State, with 2 All-Americans. Lexi Kilfoyle, who's been a little better down the stretch, but Kenny Gajewski turns to Kelly Maxwell in this elimination game.
Yeah, a veteran with a ton of experience on this stage. Kelly Maxwell has been working more of her drop ball as of late. She made an adjustment with her drop ball before regionals started to throw it a little bit more firm to get late sharp break to it. More so known for her rise ball, and that's where you see a lot of her swings and misses can come up in the zone, outside to right-handed hitters, inside to left-handed hitters, and that down area, that red area is where she likes to throw that drop ball. That drop and rise complement each other. She can spot that rise ball in any quadrant she wants to.
And here she goes, Kelly Maxwell, Kiki Malloy. An All-American off to start for Oklahoma State's ace, and a strike to Malloy. A senior, she does have another year of eligibility left. Only Ashley Rogers runs out of eligibility among scholarship Tennessee players after the game, so Malloy expected to return, but not wanting her season to end here as she falls behind quickly against Maxwell.
Kelly Maxwell, one of the best swing and miss pitchers in the country, one of the toughest pitchers to go up against when she gets two strikes against you.
Ball.
Strikeout number this year, 226 in 140 and a third innings. Second in the nation in strikeouts per seven, only behind the pitcher we just saw get a win on this field, Stanford's Nigeri Kennedy. 2-2 for Kiki Malloy. Maxwell and Malloy, two terrific careers. Both at the same school for their entire career.
Ball.
And it's gone from 0-2 to 3-2 now on Kiki Malloy.
It's definitely something to pay attention to when Kelly Maxwell is in the circle, and her outing today is how much she quote-unquote nibbles, as Coach Gajewski likes to call it. A few more walks per seven innings pitch this season.
Malloy swinging away and lacing one to right field. She had Tennessee's only hit of the game yesterday against Oklahoma to lead off the action, and she has a leadoff base hit here.
And Kiki Malloy knew that this is where she had to throw this rise ball. She likes to go to her arm side of the plate with this rise ball. It was the only pitch that she threw for a strike within that at bat. So, of course, Kelly Maxwell goes right back to it. Kiki Malloy and that at bat did not have to worry about that drop ball at all. It was a blatant ball. She knew she was going to come up, and a beautiful line drive swing.
Brings up Zeta Pooney. So Tennessee, one hit against Oklahoma yesterday. Jordy Ball started the game. Patty Gasso works to Rocco May and Deal all in for the last couple of batters.
Ball.
They had 10 runs in the opener against Alabama Thursday, and Pooney drove in a couple with a booming double in the second inning. She has had a breakout NCAA tournament. Aaron Weekly telling us before the tournament, she thinks Zeta Pooney could become the most fearsome hitter in the country. Pooney hits a ground ball to Maxwell. She'll spin and go to second, and they do not get the out at Pooney on first. Becker's throw deemed a little bit late, but Maxwell does well to get the lead runner.
Well, guys, this morning in our production meeting, we played the guessing game, right? Will it be Kelly Maxwell? Will it be Lexi Kilfoyle? And I'd say the majority of us thought that would be Lexi Kilfoyle because her numbers as of late have been a bit better. But I asked Kenny Gajewski before this game, why Maxwell? And he said, well, he laughed. He said, because she's Kelly freaking Maxwell. And she's dynamic. Look, when she is on, nobody can touch her. He did tell me there's going to be a short leash. Lexi Kilfoyle will be ready to go. But he absolutely trusts Kelly Maxwell in this game.
She's Kelly freaking Maxwell. What more is there to say than that? Thanks for getting that, Courtney. And yeah, it's an interesting call because Lexi Kilfoyle, five-inning shutout against Utah a couple of days ago.
Ball.
Maxwell, who throws ball two to Boo Gibson, only lasted two innings against Florida State because of a rain delay. They didn't want to bring her back out. Gave up a two-run homer in the first. The start before that, however, Maxwell took a perfect game into the seventh inning against Oregon in Super Regionals. So with the season on the line, it's Kelly Maxwell, whose pitch is grounded to third, and it sneaks between the legs of Megan Bloodworth. An error on the Oklahoma State third baseman puts a couple of Lady Vols on.
And we talked about that drop ball earlier to the first at bat to Kiki Malloy, and she threw it to Pooney and Gibson as well and gets them to chase out of the zone. They're out in front of that pitch. That is a drop ball that's going to continue to move down and out of the zone. And Megan Bloodworth just can't handle it. This is a play that needs to be made. There is so much spin on it, but a play that she will make 9 times out of 10.
Ball. It's outside. Oklahoma State's third error of the World Series, and Bloodworth with her 11th. So two on and one out now for Riley West.
Ball, that's outside.
Riley bopped a three-run homer on Thursday against Alabama. One of five on the year.
And Riley West has been getting some good swings here at the Women's College World Series. On Thursday, she hit a home run off of Alex Salter on a changeup, playing Alabama, two familiar teams with each other. And Riley West got all of that one, hitting the stake up in the zone, and of course did the Tennessee home run celebration through the dugout with the money that apparently has faces and their names on it, we come to find out.
Ball.
And that's what we'll be doing when we finish a successful broadcast, having dollar bills with your face and mine on it. That's yeah. What I'm being told.
Just make it rain.
Right. We'll have more on that Tennessee celebration next inning. Oklahoma State's got one of their own as well. 3-1 to West. That ball is sharp from Kelly Maxwell.
And we saw that drop ball in her scouting report being a pitch that she's leaned on more here at the World Series and more here in the first inning. Good sign if she's getting a swing and miss on this pitch. And Pooney and Gibson both hit ground balls off the end of their bat on this same pitch. That pitch is working. It's going to complement her rise ball well.
Goes to the rise ball here. Gets a pop up on the infield for an infield fly at out number two. So a little early count nibbling, as Kenny Gajewski calls it, for Maxwell. She finds the stuff and finds the strike zone late. Her seventh career game at the World Series, 47 strikeouts in 27 innings. Her third year pitching on this stage. And she'll face Mackenzie Donahue.
Ball, that's outside.
The last time Kelly Maxwell faced Mackenzie Donahue, Mackenzie, of course, was wearing Oklahoma colors in the Bedlam rivalry. All-World Series team with the Sooners 2 years ago.
It's a good sequence right there. Didn't get the call for that rise ball away. It was a close pitch. I thought it could have easily been called a strike, so she goes to that drop ball to get back into the count.
A 1-1.
Ball, that's outside.
She is really trying to find that outside corner. Found it there.
You see her within this at bat just trying to find where to put that rise ball. That is a rise ball. And when we say that she can put it in every quadrant, she can absolutely put it in every quadrant. She can throw it at the knees. She can throw it up at the hand level. She can put it where she wants to.
Two on, two out, 2-2 pitch. Donahue swings and misses. In and out of traffic for Kelly Maxwell. And a scoreless first inning for both All-American aces.
Kelly Maxwell knew how she wanted to attack Mackenzie Donahue. It was with this rise ball on the outside corner, all at bat long, and she gets her.
Welcome back to the Women's College World Series. One of the things that makes softball so unique and fun is everything that happens in the dugouts, like my friend Bullet here, or in the Tennessee dugout. You might see the mommy hat when they hit a home run. They might throw money and use the pimp bat. So there's so many fun traditions, and how this all started was, especially for Bullet, was when Oklahoma State went to Broken Bow during the selection show. Several different elementary schools came in their locker room and decorated, and guess what? They left this guy there. And guys, there's actually t-shirts that were made up in the stands now that fans wore. They've already sold out, I've been told. The tradition of the mommy hat for Tennessee, that actually came from the Tennessee baseball team. They had a daddy hat and it got banned. So the Tennessee softball team was like, no, we're doing our own thing. We're gonna wear the mommy hat. So you hit a home run, you get the mommy hat.
And you get to walk through the money pit as well. There's Bailey Rutter, who is the official Bullet writer. And Bullet also makes his way into post-game interviews frequently. Yeah. Great job of not being intimidated by Bullet's thorny presence right there by Courtney as well. He's an intimidating fellow, Bullet, rocking the red bandana today. Bailey Rutter is the official keeper of the horse in the dugout.
Ball.
2-0 for Caitlin Carwile.
Well, and Bullet will wear different outfits, too, that we've seen. Mm-hmm. So a few different looks that Bullet has. Gets dressed up for the games.
Yeah, Bullet, big fan of Rent the Runway. Hey, whatever it takes, this Oklahoma State team found a new life after their retreat to Broken Bow. It's a retreat they've been on the last few years after the season ends. During the selection show and then the first couple of days before regional start.
Ball.
They were just 2-11 heading into the NCAA tournament, Oklahoma State, and they have gone 6-1 in the tournament, sweeping their way through regionals and supers and winning one of two here in Oklahoma City. Hey. Carwile takes a strike, 3-2. There's Bullet. They are sold out now.
It's a feather boa right there. That's one of the looks that Bullet likes to pull out come game time.
Carwile down looking, a strikeout for Ashley Rogers is her first. Well, when Oklahoma State made it back from Broken Bow, their locker room was decorated by local elementary schools, Westwood, Morrison, and Richmond elementary schools. You see the signs of encouragement for the players. It was a surprise to them when they came back. And they had a little horse in the gift basket. That became Bullet. The name, by the way, comes from Bullet, the, I don't want to say real horse. I don't want to insult this Bullet, but you know what I mean. The real horse who rides around the field during Oklahoma State football games. Whole crowd chants OSU, OSU. So if you score, you get to ride Bullet. Or Bailey Rutter, a reserve on the roster, will just take care of that herself. Freshman Michaela Work here. And Work pops one into left center. Malloy makes the play. It's a no-fly zone in center field for Tennessee. A home run robbery yesterday, and she takes away a hit today.
Yeah, Kiki Malloy can cover so much ground in center field. She can go back. She can come forward. She can go across. Lays out for this one in left center field. We saw her rob a home run against Oklahoma yesterday. Ashley Rogers loves when her defense plays like that. I have a great stat from 643 Charts, Kevin, that Tennessee has the number two team in defensive efficiency. And when Ashley Rogers is in the circle, she has the best defensive efficiency back behind her in the country. So defense lays out for balls like that. There's softer contact. When she's in the circle, the defense steps up. They're positioned correctly, and they make plays like Kiki Malloy.
Defensive efficiency, by the way, that's percentage of balls in play that turn into outs. So You hit it in the air to center field. Kiki's going to get it. Katie Taylor, Riley West are very good in the corners as well. Zeta Pooney has improved her game down to third. And again, it's not the first time we've seen Kiki take away a hit in this World Series. This was just yesterday.
And went back up against the wall in center field, stretched at the perfect moment, and got to say that she robbed a home run at the Women's College World Series, also had a diving catch in Oklahoma City. A defender that, like I said, can just cover a ton of ground and take away hits.
Looking like her dad lawyer going all out for an interception. Talon Edwards, the freshman left fielder, against Rogers here. And Edwards sprays a two-strike pitch out of play.
Do you know who the number one team is in defensive efficiency?
Well, let's see. I'm going to guess it's the team that's the number one team in everything else. Is it Oklahoma?
Yes, that's right. At a 763 clip, Tennessee at 761, so just a little bit behind them.
We'll see Oklahoma tomorrow, noon Eastern, 11 local on this field against Stanford. Edwards pops it up. Well, a leadoff walk for Becker. Five in a row retired since then. You're liking what you're seeing from Ashley Rogers so far?
I think that she looks very sharp. I think she looks sharper than what we saw from her earlier on in the Women's College World Series and what I saw from her at Super Regionals too against Texas.
That's right back to Rogers, but it redirects off her glove and Edwards will reach first base. That defensive efficiency just took a little hit. Off the glove of Rogers, it's an infield single.
Coach Gajewski says about Talon Edwards that her bat-to-ball skill is elite. That was an outside pitch that she hit so hard right back at Ashley Rogers, who had a chance to get this ball in her glove. It hits off the side of her glove instead of going back into the pocket, and it's going to be a hit for Edwards.
Ball. Ball one now to Taylor Tuck, the fifth-year senior. Four fifth-year seniors, actually five in the starting lineup for Oklahoma State. Becker, Factor, Naomi, and Wynn, the top four hitters.
Ball.
And Tuck, who's steadily improved her game over the course of her Oklahoma State career. A couple of years ago, splitting time with Julia Cottrell, who transferred out. So Tuck has been the unquestioned starter this season. Soaked in sunshine and fair territory right now. Some shadows over the foul ground down the left field line. Rogers lost control of that one for ball three. It's Julia Katsoyanopoulos behind the plate, had to corral it. First year catcher. Grade two.
Throwing that backdoor curveball that she'll throw outside to lefties, inside to righties. Doesn't have a screwball. She'll rely on that backdoor curveball to take care of the arm side of the plate. Ooh, nice catch. That's why you bring your glove to the ballpark right there. What a stretch. That was a great catch by a young girl.
Well, there are a lot of kids who are playing softball tournaments in Oklahoma City this week. Maybe she's one of them. Pitch number seven to Tuck, and another fan will have an opportunity to make a catch. And they will, barehanded.
Ashley Rogers, her batted ball profile shows that she has 70% of the balls in the air. So these fans get to have a chance to catch quite a few with that rise ball and her curveball with upspin.
Here comes another one. Look out below. That one was dropped. It's an EF error fan. All's well that ends well.
Ow, that hurt. Ow.
Yeah. Harder than I think. Ninth pitch of the at bat. Tuck just loves the stadium. She loves the fans. She loves delivering souvenirs, although this one's going to roll down the net. I think everyone in the stadium this week, with all of the long at bats, has gotten a foul ball except us. Even Beth got one yesterday.
Ball.
That is outside. Tuck tosses the bat away with some pace, and she deserves to. A heck of a battle for a walk for Taylor Tuck. 10 pitches to do so and put a couple of cowgirls on.
And making a lot of contact in that at bat, a lot of fouls off of her bat to be able to draw that walk. And paying attention to the swings and misses that Rogers has gotten in the postseason at the SEC tournament, 17% whiff rate. Regionals stepped it up to 33%. But then since then, that number has started to trickle down. Talked about what we saw from her in the Supers and earlier on in the Women's College World Series, and there have just been times where she hasn't looked as sharp as what we saw in February and March, when that number on the season for her overall is about a 27% whiff rate. So 8 is very low for her.
Ball.
Her next pitch will be her 30th of the inning as she works it to 1-1 on Megan Bloodworth. After a 17 pitch first. Second in the nation in ERA, Rogers, but not quite the same pitcher down the stretch. 4 innings, 2 runs, walked 3, only struck out 1 against Alabama Thursday. Tennessee chose not to go with Rogers yesterday against Oklahoma, went with a full staff approach. Julia Katsoyanopoulos going to lead a meeting in a circle here.
Yeah, and that was big talk in the softball world for why Ashley Rogers did not get the start, why didn't Peyton Gottschall get the start. And Karen Weekly decided that she wanted to go with Carlin Pickens, and it shocked the softball world.
And here's what Karen said after the game. Felt like Carlin presented a pretty good option to start with. The people we put in there, she thought, had the pitches in their arsenal that would be most successful, though she said if they had the lead late, Ashley would be the back end person. It was an interesting approach because Rogers and Gottschall did not pitch. Pickens started, a freshman who throws very hard. We saw her at 76. Had a scoreless first, gave up a 3-run home run to Tiare Jennings. And at that point, Tennessee decided to conserve its 2 best pitchers. And again, they would eventually lose 9-0. What'd you make of the way that Karen Weekly handled the pitching staff in that game?
Yeah, I think that Carlin Pickens looked good early on in that game, and it was a surprise. I think everybody was surprised to see her because that was her first innings in the Women's College World Series being a freshman, and the way that she had pitched down the stretch, the numbers backed it up. She'd just been giving up a lot of walks, a lot of hits, a lot of earned runs. So definitely a surprise to see her get the start. And then I do think, Kevin, that once Oklahoma went up 3-0, that I just don't think that you're going to see Ashley Rogers or Peyton Gottschall at that point, which speaks volumes about the pitching staff for OU because Tennessee's offense is so good.
Pickens, Riley White, Charlie Orsini, Nicola Simpson, who are the 4 least used pitchers out of the 6 on the staff. Another 3-2. This is popped up by Bloodworth. Rogers will call it, take control of her circle, and finish a marathon inning by stranding a pair of cowgirls.
The NCAA Women's College World Series is presented by Capital One. What's in your wallet?
Thank you. This College World Series commemorative ticket. Again, fans, scan the QR code on the video board now to purchase your commemorative tickets tonight.
Last year at the World Series, Oklahoma State was a win away from the Champ Series. Kelly Maxwell had a 5-0 lead through three until Courtney Day's three-run homer for Texas in the fourth. And then all you know what broke loose in the fifth inning on this ground ball from Bella Dayton, an error in right, an error at first. Three runs scored, and Texas put six across against Kelly Maxwell for a 6-5 win. A couple of those obviously were unearned. The number is still very good in the World Series for Maxwell, but she was on the mound with a 5-run lead and 12 outs to go. And Oklahoma State could not score after the third, lost the game 6-5, and saw Texas make it to the Champ Series last year. Kelly's first pitch of this inning to Jameson Brockenbro is popped up to Kylie Naomi at shortstop. It's a big stage for Kelly Maxwell to be back on. And Kenny Gajewski has been pretty open with us about how he did or did not talk about the end of last season with Kelly Maxwell. He said, I don't know if as a head coach I did a good enough job of putting that Texas loss to bed for her.
Ball.
That's high to Destiny Rodriguez. Kenny said, look, I never saw Kelly Maxwell as being the problem. We're not even there. We're not close to being there without her. Always seems so in charge, so locked in, so emotionally stable that frankly he never thought she was phased. And has had some conversations lately with Kelly, and in fact ran into Kelly's parents recently and had a conversation with them about it. And just didn't feel like he addressed it the way it should have been addressed, either right after the moment or at some point in the offseason. But they've had that conversation now.
Ball.
Guys, Kelly's parents, Mark and Susan, they're in the stands, and I got to catch up with them before this game, and I just asked, what has this season been like for Kelly after how last season ended? And they told me, look, it's been a lot of pressure on her, but she is so competitive. And I said, well, where does that come from? When did you first notice that? And they told me a story. When she was growing up, she was only playing with the boys. Her brother and all of her cousins were boys. There was probably a 4-year age difference, and they were playing baseball in the backyard, and she would just go out there and really have to up her game. And so that competitiveness was born then. That's really helped her get through this tough time and the pressure.
On the ground, a second from Rodriguez, and Kelly's got two outs in the second inning.
Yeah, and Courtney, she's continually upped her game. You think about early on in her career, Coach Gajewski had told her, look, I don't think that you're going to pitch here. But she went into the offseason, did some changes, worked hard, just put in more work, worked even harder than she was before to earn a starting spot and to earn pitching time. And then she has become an All-American, one of the best swing and miss pitchers in the country.
Two down for Julia Kutsoyanopoulos.
Ball.
And even changing her windup too. Kelly used to have a backswing with her pre-motion where the ball would come out of her glove and then she would move forward, and now she stays in her glove. That was a change that at times was difficult for her to make, but she made it. And even get this, you guys, that rise ball that we have come to know and love that Kelly throws, she didn't even have that until she got to college. That's it right there.
It's not a curveball, she told us. Everybody thinks it's a curveball, but it is a rise ball. Working this year, late in the season, on starting the rise. A ball off the plate rather than just trying to nick the corner.
Ball.
That one's a little off the plate, a little too far for ball two. First year Lady Vol in the converted catcher, Katsoyanopoulos batting. Just two hits in this postseason for her.
Ball.
Three ball counts in the first eight batters for Maxwell, who has to date avoided a walk. Hitter with a very good eye, Katsoyanopoulos. But she'll swing and miss on 3-2, and that is Kelly Maxwell. That's the daughter of Susan and Mark right there, or as her coach calls her, Kelly freaking Maxwell.
She called that pitch on her own. Whenever she swiped her glove up and down her uniform, it was because this was the pitch that she wanted. A drop ball, a little bit off speed. Her parents love it. Oklahoma State fans love it. Big strikeout for Maxwell on the drop.
Only one question we're going to ask you, okay? If you get it right, you're going home with a prize. So, let's see how confident you are in saving your money, all right? So, we're going to put it up on the board. How much money should you put aside for emergencies? Is it A, 40%, B, 20%, or C, 1%?
Megan's always been there for you. You owe her. If you don't make this right for her, Luke, I swear to God.
Hold on. I've known Megan her whole life. You've known her for like 5 minutes. Okay, this is our town. You're just a tourist.
Megan's always been there for you. You owe her. If you don't make this right for her, Luke, I swear to God.
Hold on. I've known Megan her whole life. You've known her for like 5 minutes. Okay, this is our town. You're just a tourist.
Back up. What are you guys doing? Like, we need more attention. Stop.
Luke. Give me a hand.
You don't want to miss the big reveal in Freeform's hit show, Cruel Summer, with a new season premiering this Monday at 9, 8 Central. And next day on Hulu. June the 4th, early summer here in Oklahoma City, no score. elimination game on a Sunday night. Oklahoma State and Tennessee. The winner of this game will play third-seeded Florida State tomorrow night at 6 local, 7 Eastern. Loser season is done. Rachel Becker will bat for a second time. It's the top of the Oklahoma State order against Ashley Rogers, who threw a gaudy 34 pitches in that second inning. Got out of it stranding a couple of Oklahoma State players.
Ball.
Becker led off the game with a walk. Second team All-American, her second straight season as an All-American.
Ball.
Came here as a grad transfer. Kenny Gajewski said she struggled a little bit down the stretch, but when the postseason began, it felt like her season kind of started over again. Had a long on base streak, an Oklahoma State record 49 straight. He thought that may have worn her down a little bit at the end of the year. The on base streak ended, the postseason began, and he said she could just start to forget about all that and start over. Time for the nation's lead in doubles, top 10, and a whole bunch of other things. Becker pops it up left side. Donahue going out, and Donahue sprawls to reel it in right at the feet of her left fielder West.
Yeah, the whole time that she was dropping back, you could tell that she just wasn't completely sure where Riley West was, and she was kind of tracking her, kind of floating back, going back on this ball, took a look, and then trying to communicate between Riley West and her and just Donahue. We've seen her lay out in that area, out in the outfield before when she was here with Oklahoma. This time playing a different position, but whew. Ashley's like, that was a close one.
Ball.
So two diving plays made by Tennessee defenders. Donahue had a terrific play for Tennessee on Thursday against Alabama as well. Cheyenne Factor. That's going to be a little too far for Donahue. Easy pickings for Kiki Malloy. Two down, here's Naomi.
Ball.
And after that last inning that Ashley Rogers pitched, she needs an efficient inning. 60 pitches, not even through three innings yet.
Through 75 pitches in just four innings Thursday. Ball. Karen Weekly told us that between her start in the Super Regionals Friday and her start on Thursday, she did not throw a bullpen. 5 years, a lot of different injuries, arm, shoulder issues during her career. They have really tried to manage her. Her innings are down this year in part because of the addition of Peyton Gottschall, a transfer from Bowling Green. And here is Ashley Rogers, second in the nation in ERA, first in the nation in hits allowed per seven, and able to fight through to the end. Puna gives it a look, that's out of play.
Yeah, Coach Weekly talked about just that deep pitching staff that they have and how it's just taken a load off of her. And they've really just leaned on Ashley Rogers and relied on her over her career. So this year and her last year had some help around her. There's Peyton Gottschall in the dugout. The transfer from Bowling Green came in with hundreds of innings of experience.
Naomi rips it foul. They call Ashley Rogers the grandma of the pitching staff. Peyton Gottschall is the mom of the pitching staff. She does have another year left, Gottschall, but Rogers is out of eligibility. Might very well see Gottschall today pitched in relief against Alabama. Naomi waits back, grounds one to third. Good pick, Pooney, in a 1-2-3 inning against Oklahoma State's 1-2-3. 9-1-2 coming up for the Lady Vols in beautiful Oklahoma City. Bracket update brought to you by Enterprise as we continue what's been, as always, a fantastically fun World Series. Stanford winning today in an elimination game. They'll need to win two tomorrow against Oklahoma. Florida State awaits the winner of this one. Tennessee has not been to the semis since Madison Shipman's Lady Vols a decade ago. Oklahoma State trying to get back there for the second consecutive year. Two teams without a World Series championship. Oklahoma State in its 11th appearance, Tennessee in its 8th. Oklahoma State, the most World Series appearances of any school without a title. Tennessee, if it does not win a title this year, would tie Nebraska for the second most, 8 appearances without a championship. Lady Vols made it to the Champ Series in 07 and 13. Cowgirls have never made it there. Katie Taylor, a 9-hitter, takes a strike from Kelly Maxwell. Taylor's had a nice postseason in the 9 spot. 6 out of 15, 2 walks, hit by 2 pitches. One and two.
Good rise ball there by Kelly, getting about 33% swing and miss rate through the first 2 innings. She averages close to 40%. That's how good her rise ball is. That's how good her drop ball is. Her drop ball working well today too.
Ball.
We saw Kelly struggle down the stretch as part of that 2-11 stretch. The near perfect game against Oregon, though, a couple of starts ago, pitched very well in regionals.
Ball. Hello.
What's been different to you the last 3 weeks or so about Kelly Maxwell?
I think it's the way that she's attacking hitters, just not missing too many pitches that are outside the strike zone with both her rise and her drop ball, just going right at hitters. You're seeing fewer 3 ball counts and a few fewer walks.
Just got to look at John Barkfeld, her pitching coach, who has been a fantastic help for Kelly and this staff. His third year was at Tulsa. Kenny Gajewski's called him the best pitch caller in the game. Was a baseball player, was drafted by the Cubs a couple of years in the minor leagues. Played high-level men's fast pitch as well. A strikeout there. John dials up a good one, and Kelly executes it for her third strikeout.
Both her rise ball and her drop ball are working well the first time through the order. Kiki Malloy is about to come up, but this first time through, her drop ball is what stood out to me, getting Tennessee to chase his pitch out of the zone down, getting out in front of her drop ball. Her drop ball is a little bit off speed. She's being able to locate that pitch, start it at a good height, and get Tennessee to chase out of the strike zone the first time through. Like that.
Told us that she changed her changeup the last couple of weeks. She started to throw her changeup a little harder. How does that play along with the drop ball and the rise ball?
I think she pretty much believes her drop ball and her changeup are the same thing and interchangeable. So it has been that off-speed pitch, her changeup, or what she says is her drop ball, be a little bit more firm. And an adjustment that she made to throw it harder to get sharper break on the ball is what she told us. And I think for her, it's always good to see the first time through the order that she didn't walk anybody, that she's attacking hitters, and even the times that she has fallen behind 2-0, Tennessee has been in some hitters' counts. She's still been able to make pitches and get outs.
Malloy, the only hit of the game for Tennessee, the only base runner to reach safely. That was the case for the full game yesterday against Oklahoma. It's been the case one revolution through the lineup here. One home run shy of the SEC single season record, Kiki Malloy.
Ball.
Alabama's Bailey Hemphill, Mississippi State's Mia Davidson in the last few years. Each hit 26 in a season. Malloy with a good count to do it. And she'll take ball four instead. The only hit, the only walk of this game for Tennessee belonged to Kiki Malloy.
You know, the numbers kind of back it up. She just walked Kiki Malloy there. We were just talking about how she hadn't walked anybody up to this point. But that is something that Kelly has been doing more, is giving up a few more walks. And when you look at her numbers from last year to this year, and specifically her first pitch strike, the amount of times that she wins the 1-1 count, and her swing and miss percentage, you can see it in the numbers.
There goes Malloy. Taylor Tuck's throw, a one-hopper, will not make it. Kiki Malloy now 40 steals out of 41 tries on the season. Make it a 25-40 season for Kiki.
She can cover ground in the outfield. She can cover ground in 60 feet whenever she moves first to second on this steal. Clearly getting in there easily. Got a great jump.
She's the only player in Division I with a slugging of 650 or better and 30 or more steals. And she's slugging 963, and she has 40 steals. She's outswiped two entire SEC teams. Zeta Pooney belts one in the right. Carwile is back, and this ball is off the fence. Malloy got a late break. She'll come around third. She will score, and Tennessee takes the lead. Nobody's driven in more runs in this postseason than Zeta Pooney. Make it 14 now for the Lady Vols, number two hitter and emerging superstar.
And Kiki Malloy can show that patience to draw the walk, to find a way to get on base, because she too has confidence in Pooney hitting behind her. That's a side of the plate that Kelly Maxwell likes to go to, that rise ball about belt high outside to a right-handed hitter. Chris Malvo, the hitting coach, was jumping up and down when he saw that swing. Pooney let it get deep. It's well over the head of Carwile, who misplays it a little bit off the wall, and because Malloy got to second base, she uses her wheels too to get home, even though she had to pause to see if Carwile was going to catch that in the air.
8-1 teams when scoring first in the World Series. Tennessee cracks Kelly Maxwell in the third, and the Lady Vols do send in a pinch runner for Pooney. It's Briley Masusin standing behind Maxwell.
Guys, and how does Zeta Pooney do this? She told us she does not like to watch film. She likes minimal information on these pitchers, but yet she still had so much success, Amanda.
She just believes in her eye, believes in her preparation, on her swing. And so, I mean, so many hitters just don't want to know what's coming. They just would rather see ball, hit ball, and I think that Zeta Pooney is an athlete, a hitter that just likes to go up and trust her eyes and her plan.
Told us her only question on a pitcher is she fast? Boo Gibson with an out and a run in.
Been so important to put her back behind Kiki Malloy too, to give her protection, because then, like I was saying, Kiki Malloy can just have the confidence to take that walk. Kiki Malloy has been so patient this year.
Ball.
Good play by Tuck, but it's ball three to the second team All-American, McKenna Boo Gibson. Already 7-3 ball counts to 12 Tennessee hitters. And another walk. So the second time through the order, two walks and a double for Tennessee against Kelly Maxwell.
Interested to see if Coach Gajewski goes to his bullpen. He talked to Courtney and before the game and talked about a short leash. John Barkfelt's going to go out and chat with her.
Lexi Kilfoyle appears to be out in the Oklahoma State bullpen. Kenny Gajewski is going to make a late breakout as well with a word for Kylie Naomi. Well, Tennessee brings in another pinch runner, the walk-on Shakara Goodlow. Masusin and Goodlow are probably Tennessee's top two pinch runners. That tells you that Karen Weekly really thinks runs are going to be at a premium here. She's going to use maybe your two top pinch runners in the third. And a ball thrown to Riley West. Nine first pitch balls to 13 batters for Maxwell.
Seems like Tennessee right-handed hitters start to be aggressive on that rise ball outside, and it's a pitch that Kelly likes to go to. And even Coach Gajewski talked to us that before the Super Regional, he had a conversation with Kelly and Coach Barkfelt about going more inside with her rise ball, challenging hitters more on the inner half, something he wanted her to continue to do in the postseason.
Ball.
There's been very little on the inside half to right-handers today.
And even you think about that Michaela Edenfield home run was on a pitch on the inside corner. That was a bomb that seemed like it went about 300 feet.
Still working west away, 2-2. Riley West Jr. out of East Vail, California. Reached base 9 of her last 10. She's been so versatile for Tennessee this year. Has batted everywhere from second through eighth. Has settled in the cleanup spot in this postseason. Two pinch runners on, Masuzin and Goodloe. And West hits a ground ball wide of Naomi at short. Masuzin, the pinch runner, is waved around. The throw is offline. Goodloe takes third and West second. Riley West with another RBI. A big three-run home run against Alabama on Thursday. And an RBI single against Oklahoma State here. It is 2-0 Lady Vols.
They were playing her more toward the right side of the field, and you can tell Riley West and these hitters just having the mindset to stay on top of that rise ball. That's what she did, try to get her barrel on top of that rise to level out their swing. And Kylie Naomi, who was playing more up the middle of the field, that ball beat her. I just was looking down at the field and noticed the big shift that was on for Riley West, more toward the right side, and Kylie Naomi out of her normal position. Would have normally been a ground ball to short.
Kenny Gajewski told Courtney before the game that he would have a short leash for Kelly Maxwell, and he is true to his word. 2 1/3 innings for Maxwell. Got in trouble with a couple of walks, gave up a couple of hits. It'll be Lexi Kilfoyle with Tennessee on top. Kelly Maxwell lasted just two innings before a weather delay on Thursday night. She makes it a third of an inning longer tonight. Gives up two and leaves with a couple on base. And with Oklahoma State down 2-0, the Cowgirls will turn to Lexi Kilfoyle, the third team All-American, who will try to get them out of this pickle.
And Lexi Kilfoyle is all about her drop ball and her changeup. She can change speeds very well, dropping it down to well below 60 miles an hour with her changeup, and work her drop ball on both sides of the plate. This pitch just tumbles down. That over-the-top spin and her height creates such down movement. She lives in the bottom of the zone. This is where she got her outs the other night against Utah. Fills up the bottom of the zone, and it's where she gets her swings and misses too. You'll notice about her that she throws to both sides of the plate pretty equally, likes to stay down the zone. Again, that red area where she gets her swings and misses does not just lean on one side of the plate. She throws to both.
She is not always a huge strikeout pitcher, and a ground ball could be dangerous here with a good speed of Goodloe at third. The batter, Mackenzie Donahue, with the infield pinched in. And Kilfoyle's first pitch is in the dirt. The second time through the order, Tennessee has seen all four batters reach base. Two walks, two hits.
Ball.
Lexi Kilfoyle pitched against Tennessee a couple of times in 2021 with Alabama, including a complete game. Her first Oklahoma State season, named a third team All-American. She's been their best pitcher down the stretch. 3-0 for Donahue.
Big shift on again with the outfield, especially, and the infield is pulled in because of runners at second and third at the moment, but you see where their outfield is shifted to toward the right side, especially Riley West. It's the same shift that they were playing especially Talon Edwards, but it was Riley West who got the hit when they were also playing that shift.
Donahue ends up walking on four pitches. Wonder how much of that was maybe just to set up a force everywhere, but it does remove the margin for error for Kilfoyle against Jameson Rockenbro. With how good Tennessee's pitching staff has been this season, feels like the year might be on the line right now for Oklahoma State. And ball one to the freshman Brockenbro. And a big two-run home run to center field on Thursday. A future star, they think, out of Locust Grove, Georgia. There's the chant, "I love Brockenbro," out of the Tennessee fans. They loved this a few days ago.
They sure did, and got a pitch that was left out over the middle of the plate down in the zone, and she was able to get her barrel down to that pitch. Beautiful swing for the freshman. Not a big stature, but has a lot of pop at times.
Brockenbro right back to Kilfoyle. Gets the out at the plate. No play at first. But Kilfoyle with that drop ball is able to induce an easy grounder for out number two.
This could have been a double play. I mean, Brockenbro has fantastic speed and she's coming out of the left-handed batter's box, but you'll notice that Kilfoyle can't get a grip on the ball right there. Just a slight pause. And I think that throws off the timing of everything with the movement of the defense. It would have been close at first, but because of that bobble, really no chance.
So the base is loaded, two outs.
Ball.
And a ball to Destiny Rodriguez. Lair Boutte missed some time with a concussion recently, but though she is back, Rodriguez continues to play with a great NCAA tournament. 6-for-13 for the freshman. West with that RBI single made it 2-0. Donahue with a walk behind her. And Brockenbro reaching on a fielder's choice. A two-run third inning for Tennessee in this elimination game.
Ball.
Five grand slams for the Lady Vols with the bases loaded this season. As a team, they hit .299 overall. With the bases loaded, that jumps 85 points.
Oh.
2-2.
I don't know if you're always gonna get that call, but that call right there really helps out Lexi Kilfoyle for that second strike in the sit bat.
Tennessee so close to knocking down the door early. They've already pushed it open, and they do have the nation's ninth best pitching staff. ERA of 170. So usually you get Tennessee's arms too, and they're going to win it for you. But you get Tennessee's arms 4-5. Kenny Gajewski doesn't want to think about that. Six pitch to Rodriguez. Another 2-2. Rodriguez back to Kilfoyle again. She does a fabulous job in relief, stranding three runners. But Tennessee gets two across. Malloy, Pooney, Gibson, and West all involved in the rally. And the Lady Vols don't want to go home on Sunday night.
Women's College World Series presented by Capital One. Oklahoma State and Tennessee battling right now. We're joined by Oklahoma State head coach Kenny Gajewski. And Kenny, as you've watched this pitching staff evolve this year, what have you learned about Lexi Kilfoyle when she enters a game in relief?
I mean, she's just fearless. I mean, she comes in and she's ready. She can come in at any point, any situation, and she's going to do great things.
Adjustments against Ashley Rogers for your hitters right now?
We just got to get the barrel there. We're taking great at bats. We're working counts. We got her up, got her pitch counting up here. We just got to get the barrel there more often. We can get that done. I think we'll do some great things.
Thanks, Kenny.
All right, thank you.
Kenny Gajewski, who's taken Oklahoma State to four straight World Series, but his team is still trying to solve Ashley Rogers, the first team All-American. Top 10 finalist for National Player of the Year. And again, the swing and miss stuff isn't there in abundance. In fact, she's now walked five, struck out two in seven innings of the tournament. But there has not been a lot of hard contact against Ashley Rogers.
And you know when she's on two, when she's getting looking strikeouts, one of the best at that in terms of percentage of her strikeouts, one of the highest percentages of looking strikeouts in the country. Can set up hitters with that backdoor curveball and just the amount of pitches that she has with her rise curve change. But to your point, through three innings, just 11% whiff rate.
Has that full repertoire and so often survives with her elite spin. Not an overpowering hard thrower. Talked to Ashley a few days ago. She told us that she is a perfectionist and it's tough for her to not be able to throw as much in between starts down the stretch, because she said, if something's not working, I want to go in a bullpen and throw 500 pitches after the game and fix it.
Ball.
Yeah, she just relies on the work that she's put in as a young pitcher through high school and then in college. I mean, I can't imagine being a Division I collegiate pitcher and not having the ability to practice in between starts and time in the game. That would just bug me. But she's also just had one of her best years stats-wise, because she's been able to stay healthy. She hasn't been overthrowing. She hasn't been overused.
Rogers 3-2 to win. She is such a hard worker, Ashley Rogers, on the field and off it as well. The student and student athlete is in big, bold capital letters, because Ashley Rogers was named the SEC Scholar Athlete of the Year, 4.0 GPA, graduated with her bachelor's in kinesiology last year. And as you see, they're pursuing a master's in kinesiology with a biomechanics concentration.
Yeah, she's studying pitch limits, effects of overuse on the body, injuries from fatigue, and just overall overuse. She's done and collected data mainly on herself over the course of several years.
Popped up by Wynn. Let's take a look at some of the stuff that Ashley Rogers has been doing, working on that master's in kinesiology. Talked about the pitching injuries she's had. This is Ashley in the lab, working on biomechanic research. You can see the data visualization there, using sensors, 3D motion, to assess the effects of fatigue on pitchers, which is still a fairly new field in college softball.
Not a ton of research on it because of her career and just all the injuries that she has gone through. She wanted to try, in her own words, leave the sport better and safer than I found it through her research.
Ball outside.
Plan is to go into med school after this career ends. Want to become a sports medicine doctor, perhaps. There's a lot that she can do, Ashley Rogers. Doing it all while pitching to the second best ERA in the nation. Carwile fouls away, strike two. And when she feels good, I mean, we saw her throw 13 innings in the SEC tournament and a win last year. So when she is on her game, she is a workhorse. A strikeout of Carlisle, her first strikeout swinging of the game.
It goes to that rise ball, and you don't know necessarily what she's going to go to with two strikes. Is it the changeup? Is it the curveball? Or is it the rise ball? And she gets Carlisle to chase out of the zone with that rise ball. Second strikeout of the day for Rogers.
Both have been against Carlisle. A little more somber in that Oklahoma State dugout than it's been the last few weeks.
You know, I was looking at their scores for Oklahoma State too, and just last four games have been such lopsided scores in one way or the other. 8-0 win, 8-0 loss, 9-0 win in supers, 8-1 win in supers.
Ball.
It seems like it's either been one way or the other for them lately. Being on a lot of the winning side in the postseason, for sure.
And their last tight game was that comeback win to beat Nebraska in the regional final. Gonna have to come back here against the SEC champs. 2-1 to the freshman, Michaela Wark.
Well, and you go to the two games before that Nebraska game at regionals, it was a 6-0 score against Wichita State and a 9-0 score in six innings against UMBC. So a lot of big victories for them, used to playing from ahead.
Hey.
2-2. Duck. Graduate student from Athens. Really became their ace a couple of years ago, Rogers. Battled through injury last year. This is popped up again by Warwick and foul.
Well, and think about, too, how this year she's throwing to a new receiver back behind the plate, Julia Katsuyanopoulos. It's her first year of catching, transferred over from Arizona, where she played first and also outfield, and they put her back behind the plate this year, but she's really good framer. Gets her pitchers a lot of strikes, possibly helps Ashley Rogers with more looking strikeouts.
Told us that Julia will steal strikes for them, and Peyton Gottschall said Julia is the best receiver she's ever thrown to. They would never have known she hadn't caught. They have high standards at Tennessee for their pitchers and catchers. She has exceeded those. Left side of fair ball finally, and Wark wears down Rogers for a two-out base hit.
Really just seemed like with how this game was going, when Tennessee got on the board and Ashley Rogers getting two quick outs in this top of the fourth inning, that Oklahoma State needed a hit like this from Mikayla Wark. Gets on top of this backdoor curveball, gets her hands on top of it, and gets it past a diving Mackenzie Donahue, who lays out. But two strike hit for Oklahoma State, and Wark, two outs.
Eight pitch at bat, their second hit of the game.
Ball.
That's low to Talon Edwards, who did not swing. What adjustments do you want to see? We heard from Kenny Gajewski, but if you're an Oklahoma State fan, what can they do to better pick up Rogers?
I think exactly what Mikayla Wark just did. If you're going to swing at that rise ball, get on top of it or take it and watch it just continue to sail out of the strike zone. And I think that her changeup is working fairly well, too. So it's throwing some timing issues for Oklahoma State. And she's throwing that backdoor curveball right on the edge of the plate, not missing too much over the heart of it.
Ball.
That rise ball is high to Edwards.
The 88 pitches top of the fourth inning for Rogers. Oklahoma State's seen quite a few pitches, fouling off quite a few pitches, making her work.
Edwards drives it into right field, and that ball gets over the head of Taylor. How long can Wark run? She's waved in by Kenny Gajewski, and she will be tagged out at the plate. Kenny Gajewski is pointing at the plate. He will immediately call for a challenge, claiming obstruction. He didn't waste a second. And we'll see about this, because Kenny Gajewski was exceedingly confident that Katsuyanopoulos did not clear a path to the plate for Wark.
The ruling on the field is out. The previous play is under review.
Looking to see where Katsuyanopoulos is placed. And what I'm looking for is her
review.
Left.
The ruling on the field is upheld. We have an out.
Oh, I was going to think about obstruction in that play, but that was a quick one. One of the quicker ones that we've had, actually. Great play by the Tennessee defense. I mean, that was a great relay in from right field. And the pick by Katsuyanopoulos. We were just talking about her glove work receiving. Now she receives that throw. She picks it, makes the tag, and holds on to it for the out.
to the NCAA Women's College World Series presented by Capital One. Tennessee on top of Oklahoma State, and we're talking now with Tennessee head coach Karen Weekly. And coach, what does it look like right now managing Ashley Rogers to make sure that when her name is called to get the start, she's ready to go?
Yeah, just a lot of rest and just a lot of treatment, you know, but she's a warrior. I mean, a lot of it out there is just pure guts.
Zeta Pooney leading your team in RBI in the postseason. When she steps in the box, what stands out about her at bats?
Her presence. She's so calm. She's composed. She doesn't care at all if they walk Kiki. She's going to stay within herself. She's got a great eye at the plate. She's got a beautiful swing.
Thanks, Karen.
Thank you.
Karen Weekly's team still up 2-0 as this last play was upheld for no obstruction.
Yeah, great relay off the fence from Katie Taylor to Rodriguez, and then the pick to Katsuyanopoulos, who makes the tag. And Kenny Gajewski threw up the stop sign right here to work. She ran through it, even hesitated. And maybe if she doesn't hesitate, she gets her foot in. But the pick by Katsuyanopoulos is what stands out to me. And I'm sure everybody is wondering, too, was obstruction even talked about in that play? Because we're so used to seeing it in the postseason and called in the regular season. I'm wondering if that was looked at or thought about.
It was an awfully quick review. Ball. And Katsuyanopoulos, who made the tag, will lead off for Tennessee in the fourth. But there has to be a path for the runner to get to the base. And the judgment of the replay officials was that there was a path. Ball. Our rules analyst Christy Cornwell, she agreed with the umpires on that. No obstruction. I think we're so used to every play that's reviewed for obstruction ending up as obstruction. We saw one in the Stanford Washington game today against Kelly Lynch, but judgment was Katsuyanopoulos did leave a little bit of room there for the runner to get around, and a huge out at the plate for Oklahoma State.
Ball outside.
Tennessee's 8-9-1 here against Lexi Kilfoyle, who came on in relief of Kelly Maxwell.
Hey.
Former Arizona Wildcat who was here at the World Series 2 years ago. Kilfoyle was at the World Series for Alabama 2 years ago as well. Makes note keeping a little bit different when you cover college softball. So much movement in the transfer portal. Both teams able to grab players with previous World Series experience to their rosters. Of course, Pooney and Donahue for Tennessee as well. Right back to Kilfoyle. What a busy night. The NCAA Women's College World Series Championship Final begins Wednesday at 8 Eastern, 7 Central on ESPN. For more information and game times, go to NCAA.com, your official home for all 90 NCAA championships.
I'm gonna go get a drink.
Yes, there will be ice cream.
Midwest Intensity.
Shout out Midwest Intensity.
I think she did her own shout out. Can you do your own shout out?
Sure. You just did. My team name was Midwest Intensity. I'd be shouting it from the rafters. What were the names of your travel ball teams, your club teams? Do you have any cool names?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I mean, they were names. I don't know, they're not necessarily cool. We had a Texas Express.
I mean, they were names.
A Hitaway, okay. An Impact, and a Storm. All of the above.
I'm impressed that you remember them all.
Of course. The first team, though, was the Crickets, and I thought was probably the best name. Mm.
What was your dugout energy like on the crickets?
Very distracted and not really caring as much about the game as we did about snacks and drinking water and everything else going on inside the dugout.
I feel like a true cricket at heart with that description. Taylor lofts one to the shortstop. Naomi, she's 0 for 2. Two down, nobody on, and Kiki Malloy will bat for a third time. Tennessee center fielder with a base hit, a walk, and a steal, and a diving catch already.
I thought it was really funny, guys. Karen Weekly telling us this recruiting story of Kiki Malloy. She came to Knoxville, went on Karen and Ralph's boat, and really didn't say much, kind of calm. And she found out later, Kiki's mom told her, well, she went off that recruiting visit thinking that Karen didn't like her. And Karen said, I got the feeling that Kiki didn't like Tennessee. And what they realized was they have the same personality. This is a photo of Kiki on her recruiting visit with Ralph and Karen Weekly. And they're one of those people that keeps everything on the inside. So Karen heard Kiki respond to one of her teammates saying, look, it was a great joke, but I'm just laughing on the inside. And that really hit home for Karen.
And she's become such an amazing leader after that too, Courtney.
Yeah, she has. And she has just that. She's a rare leader that's willing to say anything to anyone, is what Coach Weekly talked about. No emotion, straight to the point. And she also said no one is going to outwork her. And when I looked at Kiki's numbers, just her ability to take a walk, see pitches better this year than last year and years before. And when you look at this game, it was her ability to take a walk that scored the first run of this game, and Zeta Pooney knocked her in.
How about that? With her 40th steal, she joins only Alabama great Kelly Kretschmann in the 25 home run, 40 stolen base season.
Ball.
You can break it down any which way with Kiki Malloy. Throw a rise ball pitcher at her, she's a 400 hitter against rise balls. You throw a drop ball pitcher at her, she's a 400 hitter against drop balls. She hits righties, she hits lefties, she hits hard throwers, she hits off speed pitches.
Ball.
A lot of folks thought Kiki Malloy should have been a top three finalist for National Player of the Year. The top 10 finalist didn't crack the top three. Maybe the best all around player left.
Looking at her numbers from last year to this year, she's taking more first pitches, taking more first strikes that she sees, and also swinging less. And it's being able to help her take more walks and also get better pitches to hit. She said, I'm looking for fatties on the plate. She puts in work with her hitting coach, Chris Malveaux, and a lot of film work to look for those fatties and hit mistakes.
Said to us, I don't know if people realize how many mistakes pitchers make. Now that's the sort of thing a confident hitter would say.
Yeah, no doubt. And she puts in work off of the field to take it to game day, and she actually executes the game plan. She looks for those fatties, fouls off pitches to take the walk.
And how about that? The indomitable Kiki Malloy is blown away by a changeup from Lexi Kilfoyle.
You nailed it. It was the changeup. Lexi Kilfoyle goes to it on a full count. It rides a little bit up, but it entices Malloy to swing. Tennessee up 2-0.
It's a good day coming.
It's a good day.
Nothing Tennessee in this win or go home game. Kelly Maxwell knocked out of the game after 2 1/3. Ashley Rogers has thrown a boatload of pitches, but not allowed a run through four. Thanks to her defense, Katie Taylor, to Destiny Rodriguez, to Julia Katsoyanopoulos for an out at the plate on a Talon Edwards double. Kayla Wark was thrown out to end the fourth. Been a really good defensive night for Tennessee. One of the nation's best hitting and pitching teams that maybe doesn't get enough credit for their defense. We've seen Malloy and Donahue make diving catches. We've seen an out at the plate on a perfectly executed relay. And the Lady Vols are 9 outs away from a trip to the World Series semis. Taylor Tuck puts one in the air to left field. And they're now 8 outs away. ESPN's next 30 for 30 film, The Luckiest Guy in the World. A four-part series which takes an unprecedented look into the life of Basketball Hall of Famer and our colleague, the great Bill Walton. First two parts premiere this Tuesday at 8 Eastern, 7 Central on ESPN. Parts 3 and 4 next Tuesday, also at 8 Eastern. Megan Bloodworth, a pop-up. Zeta Puni, a catch. And that is a way to start an inning for Ashley Rogers. Four pitches to get two outs.
And a lot of fly ball outs, eighth fly out that she's had in this game, and mixing her pitch as well. And I just like the way that she's owning that inside corner to these right-handed hitters and jamming them up like she did against Bloodworth.
Third time through now for Rachel Becker. Becker sprays it foul. Friday night, we saw Oklahoma State pick up 6 runs in the span of 18 pitches. And they have just not been able to find any kind of momentum in this game. Rogers has worked very deliberately. She has controlled the pace of the game. Oh. Now, we've seen it in the postseason time and again when Oklahoma State gets a hit, they can get another. In fact, this game they have had back-to-back runners reach twice, but one was before the 9-hitter Bloodworth, who popped out, and then last inning back-to-back batters reached, but Wark was thrown out at home.
I think we've seen their defense step up and make plays. I think that that's been a big part of this game. When you think about Donahue's catch out in front of her left fielder, when you think about Kiki Malloy's catch for that side of the field too, and then that relay throw in to home potentially save the game.
And we wonder, can anybody challenge Oklahoma? And Tennessee could not yesterday, but with Rogers pitching like this, with Peyton Gottschall potentially pitching the way she's pitched this postseason, can their defense and their hitting get them in the games? Still waiting to see. Oklahoma has been tested a little bit by Nigeri Kennedy a couple of days ago. 1-2-0, 9-0 over the Vols yesterday. Stanford will get a crack tomorrow. Florida State, one win from the Champ Series. Could this Tennessee team be championship material? Peyton Gottschall, who's thrown once in this World Series. Rogers 100 pitch.
In order to face Oklahoma, then Oklahoma, of course, would have to win tomorrow, and Tennessee would have to win twice tomorrow if they're going to get another shot at him. Big day coming up tomorrow. Could be two games, could be four games.
Well, Rachel Becker finds herself in a third consecutive full count. She does not have a hit in a full count this year. She has 9 walks. She's 0 for 27 in full counts. How is that possible? She's got an on base of 561. Now she's 0 for 28. Tennessee 6 outs away from the semis as Zeta Pooney's coming up. Let's take a look at tonight's Biggie moment brought to you by Wendy's. Kiki Malloy, after a walk, her 40th steal of the season, in position to score on this double from Zeta Pooney. And a couple of batters later, Riley West would sneak in another run. Oh, hesitation there from the pinch hitter, our pinch runner, Mazuzin. Not sure why she was stopping 10 feet from the plate, but she did score.
The funny part about that is that nobody was really at the plate because the throw took the catcher so far offline.
Those are the only runs in the game. Tennessee, the number 4 seed here in the women's softball postseason, leading the 6 seed Oklahoma State 2-0. Winner to the semifinals tomorrow. Florida State awaits, 7 Eastern, 6 Central. Florida State 2-0. The Seminoles only need one win to advance to the championship series. The winner of this game would need to win 2 games tomorrow. Same situation for Stanford, which needs to win 2 against an Oklahoma team that has only lost 1. Those games will start at 11 local, noon Eastern. Ball. And you can find them on ESPN.
I think a big part of this Tennessee lineup, Kevin, is the way that Zeta Pooney has just been able to step up hitting behind Kiki Malloy. Saw it in this game, and it just seems like when they're winning and scoring a lot of runs, Malloy and Pooney are clicking, they're getting on base, and oftentimes Pooney is driving her in or moving her around.
Hey! second in the SEC RBIs per game. Zeta Pooney has driven in 59 now, 14 in the NCAA tournament. 1-2 from Lexi Kilfoyle here.
Ball outside.
Just missed with that drop ball. Nearly a beautiful sequence. About 14 miles per hour of separation between those two.
Yeah, and that's the pitch that Zeta Pooney got out on earlier in this game, or has caused a fielder's choice with, and ended up grounding out, hitting off the end of her bat. Trying to see that pitch up.
Kilfoyle's 2-2. Pooney grounds it sharply to the right side. It's off the glove of Becker. Zeta Pooney is aboard to start the bottom of the fifth on a ball that Rachel Becker did not flag down.
And Kilfoyle went right back to that drop ball, pitched it. The pitch before goes back to it again, and Zeta Pooney stays more on it, just gets under Rachel Becker's glove. That ball is hit well, but hits off of her glove. I'm thinking that Becker thinks that's a play that she should make.
Started every game at second this year, Becker. She's only committed four errors. We'll wait for an official scorer's ruling on that one. But Tennessee has a runner on for Mackenzie Gibson. Now McKenna Gibson, beg your pardon.
Ball outside.
Been a pretty quiet NCAA tournament. Second team All-American. Top seven in the SEC in RBIs and on base percentage and slugging. But she does keep reaching base. A whole lot of walks. Beck Gibson has reached base 23 consecutive games, which is a season high. And that's why Karen Weekly told us she feels like McKenna's good and her at-bats are good. And they won't be surprised if the breakout is coming soon.
Ball.
Yeah, and when McKenna is seeing the ball well, she's spraying the ball to all parts of the field. She has as much power to left field as she has to right field. Just always finds a way to get on base.
Official scores ruling E4 against Becker, so it is an error. Her fifth of the year. Off speed again from Kilfoyle. That pitch has been working.
I can tell she's still beating herself up about it. That error still in her head.
Gotta have a short-term memory here with a ground ball pitcher. It's fouled away hard. I know you said that early in the tournament, you see the pressure of the World Series come out on defense. A couple of fairly routine plays not made by Oklahoma State tonight.
And they were so good in regionals and super regionals with their fielding percentage, they hadn't made an error.
Six pitch to Gibson.
Ball.
That's inside. Those of you looking for Stanford, Texas A&M in the NCAA baseball regionals, that game is over on ESPN News. And we'll take you out to Palo Alto after the conclusion of this one here in Oklahoma City.
A&M in the driver's seat in that regional.
Is that right?
That's right.
Feels like all the unseated teams are in the driver's seat in college baseball right now.
Yeah.
Ball.
That's a walk for Gibson, her second of the game. And here comes Tennessee with the first two runners on in the fifth inning.
Now batting for Tennessee, left fielder number five.
Riley West has another big opportunity. Carlin Pickens just went through the fence. There is the hard-throwing freshman out to the Tennessee bullpen.
We saw her throwing 75, 76 yesterday when she got that start against Oklahoma. A hard thrower. A lot of hard throwers here at the World Series.
Ball.
All one to the cleanup hitter, West. Tennessee's second most walks in the nation. They have four today. Seen 105 pitches in 22 batters now. That's about five per batter. West with an RBI single in the third.
Tennessee fans not happy about that one, getting the bottom of the zone. And Tennessee has just taken so many close pitches in this game. They've fought off some, but you can tell that they have a plan. And actually, Riley West going to take a second to talk to Karen Weekly down the third baseline.
Looked like Riley West was going to join Carlin Pickens in the bullpen for a moment. He's had a pretty determined stride down the line, and now Karen Weekly has some words for Tom Meyer.
I don't know if Karen Weekly meant to take her conference on that little chat with Riley West, but it's going to be what ends up happening.
So 1-2 on West, Pooney and Gibson the runners. And a ground ball to third. Bloodworth goes to second. The turn by Becker is not in time at first. Very close play there. Runners at the corners with one out. And we will see if Kenny Gajewski elects to use his second challenge. He's saying out. He's waiting to make sure the umpires confirm the call to him. And he has not signaled for a review.
I think I would review this if I were him.
Now batting shortstop number two.
Gets a lead out at second base, and oh, that was so close at first. Good hustle by Riley West to get down the line. Her foot, yep, just barely makes it to the bag before the throw. That's a great call at first base on a bang bang play.
Wonder if he was asking Wark, maybe the first baseman, out or safe, to see if he wanted to reserve the challenge. So it ends up being the right decision not to. First and third, one out for Donahue. And Donahue tries to squeeze in a run. Tuck throws through to second. Ball sneaks away. Here comes Pooney, and Tennessee steals a run. Taylor Tuck decides to throw through. The throw snuck into center field, and Pooney crosses for a third Tennessee run.
Just continuing to put pressure on Oklahoma State's defense in this inning right now. Just wasting no time, putting Riley West in motion. Gets away from Kylie Naomi, and an easy run for Tennessee is going to score. Remember, this inning started on an error, and then we had the walk, and then that missed opportunity for a double play, and now that ball getting away. Just not a clean defensive inning for OSU.
Ball.
That is only the second error of Taylor Tuck's career in 118 games. And it is the third error of the night for Oklahoma State.
Ball. It's outside.
Stolen base, by the way, is only the third for Riley West. But Tennessee sets up the first run with a steal from Malloy. And they compel the third run home with some action beginning on the steal.
Ball outside.
you think about how many more at-bats this has given Tennessee in this game between the walks and the errors that Oklahoma State has given to them in this game.
That tells a story. Either the graphic or Kenny Gajewski's face will do. Donahue's second walk. Five walks in the game handed out by Oklahoma State. Three errors committed. Tennessee has taken advantage. And the Lady Vols once again have two runners on.
Now batting for Tennessee, number 19, Jameson Rock and Roll.
Three walks out of the bullpen for Lexi Kilfoyle, whose control has been about as precise as it comes down the stretch. A strike to Brockenbro. Eleventh time Oklahoma State has walked five or more in a game this season. Brockenbro goes the other way. Talon Edwards has the second out in her glove as the runners retreat.
Now batting second baseman number 34, Destiny Rodriguez.
Peyton Gottschall and Carlin Pickens are running in their double barrel in the bullpen back behind left field.
Ball.
If you're Karen Weekly, you sticking with Rogers to start the sixth?
Oh, what do we have coming up? Let's take a little look. We got 2-3-4. She's throwing well, three up, three down last inning, but getting high in the pitch count. It's a tough decision. They talk a lot in between innings, too, by the way. You constantly see Karen Weekly talking to her.
And would the score matter, too, if it becomes 5-0 rather than 3-0? Maybe that impacts Karen Weekly's decision.
Yeah, absolutely. I think if they're able to push across another run, then you're more likely to see it. Maybe if not, then Ashley Rogers starts the inning. They see how it goes, the short leash.
Rodriguez 0-2. And takes a strike. The third game with three or more errors this season for Oklahoma State. They have not been at their best, and a lot of that credit must go to Tennessee for their tough at-bats, for keeping the pressure on Maxwell and Kilfoyle, two All-American pitchers. Lexi trying to leave it at three. That's a little dribbler fair, and Kilfoyle so good fielding her position. Could be the last career at-bats for some of these fifth-year seniors if Oklahoma State doesn't rally. Cheyenne Factor and Kylie Naomi, who have lived at the World Series. Morgan Wynn behind them. Maybe their last chance for the Cowgirls.
Experience. Visit ncaa.com/VIP to secure your VIP experience tonight. We'll take it down to our MC, Garrett. Take it away.
All right, fans, I'm joined with... Is it going to be Ryan?
So far, I think Ryan's in the lead. I'm trying to figure it out. Drinking some water. All right, let's cheer him on. Ryan from Tennessee.
We know three quarters of our semifinals teams, unsurprisingly Oklahoma. They'll face Stanford. Had to rally back from a loss to OU. They get a rematch tomorrow in Florida State. With a 2-0 start, its first ever at the World Series awaits tonight's winner. Noon Eastern, 11 local tomorrow. Stanford has to beat Oklahoma twice. This game's winner has to beat Florida State twice. Tall tasks, but doable. Remember 2 years ago, Oklahoma and Florida State both won twice on semifinal day. They faced off for the Champ Series, won by OU in three games. They are each a win away from a rematch. But a few teams left trying to spoil that meeting. Cheyenne Factor with a 1-1 count with Ashley Rogers still dealing for Tennessee. The fifth year senior Factor. Career game number 262, career start number 250. An all Big 12 player for 4 years. And could this be the last at bat of her career for this Oklahoma State class, which has revitalized the program? Third most games played among any active player. A quiet leader, but a leader all the same for this team. Factor loops one toward the middle. Donahue races to get it and throw her out. Donahue on the spot for the first out in the sixth.
You can see the look on her face wanting to get a hit there late in this game, knowing what's at stake. And mentioned it before, we'll see at least three seniors come up to bat in this inning.
The next one is Kylie Naomi. Last season, her numbers fell off a cliff offensively. This year, the best hitting season of her career. It has carried over into the tournament.
Ball.
1-1. Ashley Rogers, a fifth-year senior. Either the pitcher or the batter in this matchup is going to see their career come to an end tonight.
Ashley Rogers has just continued to make good pitches, and you heard Karen Weekly say earlier in this game when she was talking to Courtney, that was back in the fourth inning. It was a gutsy performance up to that point, and just continued to make pitches, and I feel like looking sharper in this game than what we saw in the first game that she pitched earlier in the World Series.
Sharper in what ways?
The way that she's living more on the edges with her curveball, and then her rise ball being more of a factor, more of a pitch that she's bringing down in the zone and not throwing it too high.
Naomi goes up the ladder there to foul one away.
And not only will she live on the edges with her backdoor curveball inside to righties, but when she's mixing her rise ball up and in on their hands with her backdoor curveball, it's hard for righties to get their hands extended. Jams them up a lot.
Ball outside.
Kylie Naomi, the most runs scored in Oklahoma State history and among the all-time leaders in everything else. 47 home runs, tied for the most. Sydney Pennington. It's been an epic career, a career that started when Kenny Gajewski recruited her out of high school. He told his athletic director, "You need to see this freshman shortstop play. It's Bo Jackson." That's popped up on the infield. And that's caught by Gibson, and Naomi is retired. Factor and Naomi both into the dugout.
And the thing that you notice about the scoreboard right now, you can't help but notice that each team has just three hits. Tennessee, even though they have the three runs, and it feels like they have a lot more runs than that. Just three hits on the board, just like Oklahoma State. Difference has been out of walks that Oklahoma State has given up and errors.
All three errors in the game committed by Oklahoma State. Tennessee's made two diving plays and has thrown out a runner at the plate. Morgan Wynn, the Kansas transfer. Two strikes on her. Oklahoma State starter, long since departed. Wynn drills it down the left field line. That ball is way out of here. The spark arrives for Oklahoma State. A smash off the bat, a smash down on the plate from Morgan Wynn, who has put the Cowgirls on the board.
They needed that swing so bad to give this team some energy. It just feels like they're a little bit flat, but maybe this, hitting this rise ball out, that was up and in our hands. We were just talking about that pitch to right-handed hitters. And with two strikes, Morgan Wynn is determined to get her barrel up and into that rise ball. That was long gone over the stands, almost to that fence out there in left field. That's 300 feet. What a bomb by the senior. Another two-strike hit for Oklahoma State. All four of their hits in this game have, two out hit for Oklahoma State. All four of them that they've had in this game have been with two outs. It's been hard to get anything going for Oklahoma State's offense.
It comes from Wynn, who has been probably their second best hitter in the postseason behind Naomi. That's her fifth extra base hit of the NCAA tournament. And she has extended the inning for Caitlin Carwile. Carwile with two strikeouts. Carwile with a fly ball off the third base side and off the railing out of play.
I mentioned that that was a two-strike home run, and three of their four hits in this game have been with two strikes. All of them with two outs.
And the tradition here at the World Series, the family gets the home run ball. I'm surprised it was retrieved that quickly, given the distance.
Yeah, no kidding.
And Carwile is down looking again, so Rogers gets the out. Tennessee will carry the lead into the bottom of the sixth, but it's a little bit closer thanks to Morgan Wynn.
Yeah, Morgan Wynn with the two-strike home run on that rise ball. She got all of that. It's getting late in this game. Can Oklahoma State find more of energy like Morgan Wynn just gave right there?
Welcome back to the NCAA Women's College World Series presented by Capital One. Oklahoma City, where Oklahoma State has gotten a little bit closer. Morgan Wynn loose enough to be singing to Kelly Clarkson after her home run. Cowgirls are within 3-1 in this elimination game. Spirit still high in the dugout. Little Kellyoke. Spirits are still high in the stands as well.
Cute.
Go Pokes, I think. Well, Oklahoma State has a tall task here. They're down two. The game that Tennessee has never trailed. Two runs in the third, one in the fifth. Oklahoma State's home run in the sixth inning from Wynn made it a little bit closer. Tom Meyer is heading over to the Tennessee dugout, pointing for a batter to move to the on-deck circle. Katie Taylor will do that. Lair Boutte is going to pinch hit against Lexi Kilfoyle in the spot of the catcher Katsianopoulos.
Ball
1-2, Boutte. Good to see Lair Boutte, who's been a regular starter this year, back from a concussion suffered recently. 364 on base percentage for Tennessee. Started 34 games this season. And Boutte knocks one out of play.
Poor Lair has just suffered some injuries this year that has kept her out at times, and it's been a big part of this offense whenever she has been healthy. Destiny Rodriguez, though, has done a good job filling in at second base and making the most out of her ABs.
She's had a couple of issues with concussions. Stress reaction in her shin earlier in the year.
Karen Weekly pointed to that turning point in their season being that series against Kentucky, and Tennessee won on Friday night. It was a close game and extra innings, and they won off of a Lair Boutte squeeze. She put it down, runner at third base. It was her first bunt that she had put down all season long. Gave them the win.
That's just foul. Tennessee's going to have Boutte, Taylor, and Malloy for Karen Weekly's team. Oklahoma State has Wark, Edwards, and Tuck waiting in the wings. The winner of this game has a date with Florida State tomorrow night. They would need to defeat the Seminoles twice to advance to the Champ Series. Just trying to get to the semis. Tennessee's not been there in 10 years. There she go, yes. Strike call to the plate. Boutte is down swinging.
Boutte trying to hold her barrel back on this check swing and does not get the call to go her way. Chasing that drop ball out of the zone, thinking it was to stay more up. It dives down.
Normally, a plate umpire will check down the line there, but Tom Meyer made the call himself. And it goes down as the first out. Katie Taylor's had a big impact on this game despite an 0-for-2. She was the right fielder on the double from Talon Edwards in the fourth. Ball soared over her head, but Taylor retrieved it and started a 9-4-2 relay to cut down Michaela Wark at the plate. Ended that rally in the fourth inning for Oklahoma State. A little tapper here. Becker gets her.
Grab the play, center field, number 9, Kiki Malone.
trying to swat the net. Is there a fly on that netting?
Could be a moth. You know, they have those here.
Could be. You try to get the moth that's been in my hotel room. Off the fists from Malloy to first, and Oklahoma State needs two runs to keep their season and some careers alive.
The NCAA Women's College World Series is presented by Capital One. What's in your wallet?
Tennessee's defense has stepped up and made plays here in this elimination game to limit Oklahoma State's offense and keep them off the base pass. A couple of diving plays by Malloy and Donahue, and then this play off the wall from Katie Taylor to Rodriguez, and then the pick by Katsuyanopoulos for the out at home. Their defense has stepped up in big ways in this game, whereas Oklahoma State's offense has committed three errors, giving up a lot of walks.
And the Lady Vols are trying to get to the semifinals for the first time since 2013. Oklahoma State needs two to tie. Ashley Rogers still out there, 122 pitches deep. The only scholarship player on the roster for Tennessee who will run out of eligibility after this season. Bunch of fourth-year players. Rogers, the only scholarship fifth-year player. She gets a strike called on a low pitch to Michaela Wart. She'll have Talon Edwards and Taylor Tuck to follow. Edwards, who is 2-for-2, following Wark, who is 1-for-2 and has hit the ball hard twice. 2-1. An Oklahoma State team loaded with fifth-year players is now reliant on two of its youngest players. Wark, a redshirt freshman who started her career at Kansas. Followed by Edwards, a true freshman who reclassified up a year. Ashley Rogers, 127th pitch of the night. is grounded on a hop to short. Donahue picks it, and the low throw is grabbed by Gibson. One out in the seventh.
That was a hard hit ball by Mikayla Wark, and Donahue has really been tested in this game. This one hit right at her. We've seen her go back. We've seen her come across the field, and this one she stays down on a short hop. Wasn't the prettiest play that we'll see, with a little bit of a bobble and a good scoop by Gibson to finish off that play, but an important first out.
It's a position we did not see her play at Oklahoma. She was that left fielder in their World Series run a couple of years ago. This season at Tennessee, she has started all 60 games at shortstop. 1-0 for Edwards.
Ball.
That's low. Two and one. Tennessee has not lost when leading after six innings the last three seasons. Edwards left side, foul territory, Pooney, and she hangs onto it up against the fence for out number two.
I mean, Tennessee's defense has just shown up big in this game. Ashley Rogers just has three strikeouts. Their infield has made plays, their outfield has made plays, and now Zeta Pooney tracks this one down in foul territory, maybe thinking that that wall and fence was closer than it really was, but she holds on to it for that second out.
And it's up to Taylor Tutt. Strike one. One of the really special stories on this team, a Stillwater, Oklahoma native, a fifth-year player who has grown and grown in prominence in this program. Tuck fouls away strike two, and the Oklahoma State Cowgirls, in a season that showed so much promise, have one strike remaining. Ashley Rogers on the 134th pitch of her night. We'll throw at least one more. Four straight trips to the World Series. All the Cowgirls who stuck around for the extra year after COVID. Every full season has ended in Oklahoma City. Tuck takes just off the plate. There's somebody who knows a thing or two about complete games in Tennessee. A changeup ends it. Ashley Rogers, a marathon performance. 130 plus pitches, a complete game win, sends Tennessee to the semis for the first time in 10 years. The fifth-year senior did not want today to be her last day in college softball. And for Oklahoma State, it is the end of this incredible journey for so many wonderful players. But Ashley Rogers, the fifth-year senior, gets the last lap tonight for Tennessee.
Through strikes, three-pitch mix with that changeup rise and her curveball that kept Oklahoma State off balance. And of course, Monica Abbott absolutely loved that complete game thrown by Ashley Rogers. We started out this game talking about how Tennessee is a complete team, depth in the circle, deep offense, and a strong defense. And boy, did their defense show up in this game. Great at bats, not a ton of hits, but they made them count. Push runs across.
Rachel Becker among the five fifth-year Oklahoma State players who see their careers end tonight because of tonight's Capital One rewarding performance. Ashley Rogers, perhaps the greatest performance of her career on 136 pitches.
Did a good job of throwing a lot of strikes and showing different pitches.
She was brilliant, and she is with Courtney Lyon.
Ashley, how did you work against these Oklahoma State hitters to keep them off balance? What was working so well?
Just continuing to mix, not relying on one spot or one pitch, just continuing to mix the entire game. Try not to let them sit one spot or one side of the plate, so just continuing to work the whole plate the whole time.
I know we've talked about how it's limited how much you can throw outside of games. How are you staying ready to come in and have performances like this?
Just fully trusting my preparation. You know, I worked here, get here, and I know I have the tools to go out there and execute. So just trusting my preparation and just trusting everybody and just go pitching freely.
You got a great defense behind you. Mackenzie Donahue with the dive, Kiki Malloy with big plays. When you see that, what does that do for you in the circle?
I mean, it just fires me up. I mean, just I think we feed off each other offensively, defensively in the circle, and just continuing to fight for each other and just going all out for each other every single pitch.
Hey, we'll see you in the semifinals. Congrats.
Thank you. Go Vols.
Tennessee has a date with Florida State. What a matchup that should be. The tough part about this event is you have to say goodbye on the other side of it. Cheyenne Factor, Kylie Naomi, Rachel Becker, Taylor Tuck, and Morgan Wynn had amazing careers. Their careers end today. Oklahoma State will never be able to thank them enough for what they did. But Oklahoma State's journey is over, and then there were four. Oklahoma and Stanford tomorrow. Florida State and Tennessee tomorrow night. Coming up next, Stanford A&M, the Mendoza-Scarborough Bowl in the NCAA Baseball Regional. We'll see you here tomorrow at noon Eastern for OU Stanford.